7 hours of sleep. और हम तो माशाल्लाह 5 घंटे की नींद मिल जाए वही बड़ी बात है. Also, when we sleep, it implies that we are giving our body time to heal itself from the wear and tear. To speak on this interesting and unique topic, we have with us Dr. Nilesh Shah sir. So it's a pleasure to have you amongst us. Before we start, I'd request a person who always exudes energy, a person who is a source of endless motivation and guidance, our principal ma'am, to address us.
Yes, madam is in traveling, Anish. So yeah. Madam will join after some time. So yes. I think we should go ahead with our session.
Okay, so we'll talk to our principal ma'am later.
Yes.
Okay, so without taking much of your time, I will give a brief intro about our speaker for today. So as we all know, Nilesh sir is quite an overachiever and a man of many and diverse talents. Sir seems to be talented right from his childhood days, being a class monitor in the third standard. And me as a third standard kid would always be thinking, how will I survive school life without my mommy? And also, sir has won the third prize in the running race in the sixth standard. And he has also acted in the drama in the ninth standard. Sir seems to be quite a dedicated individual as he has been working in the Sion Hospital as a full-time psychiatrist right from 1988. A fan of Hindi movies and traveling along with roadside food, sir is married and has twin daughters. And about his personality, sir claims to be over-anxious. Sir, it's an honor to have you here. So, sir, I would like to hand you over the stage and allow you to enlighten us. Please, sir.
Thank you very much. I'm very grateful to all of you for inviting me and giving me this opportunity to make a presentation on this very important topic, what we call sleep disorders. Are my slides visible?
Yes, sir, they are.
Okay. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. So today's topic, sleep disorders in clinical practice. In the fifth standard, the question is, what things are necessary for our survival? And in fifth standard, they tell us only about two things, air and food and water. These are the two things which are absolutely necessary for survival. But let me tell you that there is one more thing which is absolutely necessary for survival, and that is sleep. If you deprive any animal of sleep, within few days, that animal dies. So sleep is as important as food and water and as important as air. There are a number of experiments in which the animals are not allowed to fall asleep. They're continuously kept awake. And then those animals who are deprived of sleep, they die early. And that is also true for human beings. We cannot deprive anyone from sleep. The second question, which many people ask me, what is the best time to sleep and wake up? My simple answer is that we are staying on planet Earth. Now, planet Earth has its own day and night cycle. Now, if we synchronize our sleep and wake cycle with the day and night cycle, it's the most healthy way of surviving. So it is very necessary that we synchronize our sleep and wake cycle with day and night cycle. So when there is a night, we fall asleep. As soon as there is a day, we wake up. This is the most healthy practice because this rhythm has to be maintained for a variety of body activities. There are hormones which are released during daytime, during daylight, and there are hormones which are secreted at night time. And for proper health, these hormones have to be secreted in synchrony with the day and night cycle. So it is very, very important that we maintain our sleep and wake cycle along with day and night cycle. Many of us know, and it has been taught to us, that there is a clock in the brain in the area called hypothalamus. Now, setting of that clock depends on the time we wake up. So we have to every day wake up at a fixed time. If we keep on changing that time, then our body is out of rhythm, and then it is harmful to our health, harmful to our immune system, our immunity decreases, and then we are prone to develop variety of medical and psychiatric disorders. Your immunity can decrease and you can develop viral infection, COVID infection nowadays, and number of other problems like diabetes, hypertension, chronic irritable bowel syndrome, variety of disorders which are immune related may be developed. So two important things: regularity and rhythm. We all know that when you go for any orchestra, all the instruments have to play in rhythm, in the same rhythm. If the harmonium plays in one rhythm and the tabla plays in another rhythm, it will be cacophony. It will not be a music. So there has to be synchrony. And since we are staying on planet Earth, our sleep and wakeful cycle, sleep and wake cycle, has to be in synchrony with day and night cycle. So my very simple, straightforward answer to what is the best time to sleep and wake up: as soon as it starts night, we fall asleep. As soon as the day breaks, 6 o'clock, 7 o'clock, we wake up. How much do we sleep? How much sleep do we need? And as Anish said, 7 hours, I prefer 8 hours. So 7 to 9 hours of sleep is absolutely necessary for all the adults. There are people who are short sleepers and there are people who are long sleepers. There are few people who call themselves short sleeper, and instead of 7 hours of sleep, they sleep only for 6 hours or rarely only for 5 hours. And even after sleeping for 5 to 6 hours, they are very healthy, fresh, alert, and energetic. They are blessed with only 5 or 6 hours of sleep. And if they sleep only 5 to 6 hours, they will have 18 hours at their perusal to do variety of activities. People like me require 10 hours of sleep. So I am a long sleeper. I have to sleep for 10 hours for good functioning. If I don't sleep for 10 hours at night, next day, I'm a little groggy, drowsy, and I'm not able to function properly. I'm not able to sustain my attention concentration. Sleep also depends on the age as well. See, at the time of birth, newborn would sleep for 18 to 20 hours. And then as we grow older, by 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, we sleep less and less. So instead of 18 hours, we'll sleep for 15 hours. Then 12 hours, and then by the time adult, we sleep for 8 hours. And elderly people, say 60 plus people, may require still a little lesser sleep. They sleep for 6 to 7 hours. The most harmful thing is sleep deprivation. Just few months back, we had a case. I work in Sion Hospital and psychiatry department, and we had this case of an Uber driver. This Uber driver was brought in our emergency department and he was totally confused. He did not know whether it's a day or night. He did not know where he is. He was drowsy, groggy, confused, hardly able to walk, hardly able to recognize people, and as if he's dreaming, hallucinating during the daytime. And then we thought whether he has taken alcohol, whether he has taken some drugs, whether he is using cocaine, MD, like the celebrities and their sons. We did not know. We asked him, but he was too drowsy and groggy. We asked the family members. They said, no, he's a very nice person and he has never done drugs. He has never done alcohol. So we admitted him and just allowed him to sleep because he was drowsy and groggy. After 1 or 2 days, when he completed his sleep, he woke up from the sleep and then we started talking to him. He told us that he was an Uber driver and Uber had launched some scheme with the incentive that if they drive for 70 hours during a week, then they will get some incentive bonus in terms of some money. So he thought that he will get that incentive. So he started driving without sleeping at all. He would drive for 17 hours, 18 hours, 20 hours, come home, have his food, sleep for 1 or 2 hours. Again, he will go. And for last 5 days, he said he had only 1 or 2 hours of sleep during 24 hours period. No wonder he had a severe sleep deprivation. And on the 4th day, while he was driving, he dropped the customer and then he didn't know what to do, where to go. He started driving and he reached somewhere. He was totally disoriented. And then he tried to have a cup of tea to keep him awake. He couldn't. And then he became totally confused and he couldn't find out his way back. Then he called somebody and then family members went to that place. They found him and then they brought him home and they found that he was totally confused. So he was brought to our hospital. So one of the causes of total confusion, disorientation, may be sleep deprivation. And we see sleep deprivation on and off in number of people who are either driving continuously for many hours or those who are not sleeping and doing variety of other activities. Nowadays, the most common cause of sleep deprivation is internet addiction or mobile addiction. We see large number of adolescents addicted to mobiles, either playing games or either watching porn videos or surfing on the internet. So gaming addiction, porn addiction is very, very common. Internet addiction, very, very common. Mobile addiction. And these adolescents, they do not sleep at night. They continue to do something at night. They fall asleep early morning. And then they wake up at 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock in the afternoon. And within no time, they fall ill. They develop variety of problems, health problems. And they are brought to us in the hospital. The third important thing about sleep, which I would like to tell you, is sleep is a roller coaster ride. It is not a continuous process. Many of you must have learned in your first year while you are learning anatomy and physiology of human body that you are awake and then you start falling asleep. You go into stage one, that is a slight sleepiness, drowsiness, then stage two, which is a little deeper, then stage three and stage four. Stage four is very, very deep sleep, which remains after about 1.5 hours. So once you fall asleep, after 1.5 hour, you are in a very deep sleep. And then after 1.5 hour, there is a period of what is called as REM sleep, rapid eye movement sleep, which is a little lighter and not very deep sleep. The REM period is of around 20 minutes where you are little awake. Also, it is a dream sleep where you have variety of dreams and there might be some body movements. You also might wake up during that time. Elderly people might use this period to wake up, go out of the bed, go to toilet, come back and again sleep. Again, the second cycle of sleep starts. Again, you from a lighter sleep, you go into a deeper and deeper sleep. And then it's a very deep sleep. And again, after 1.5 hours, it becomes little lighter sleep. And again, around 20 minutes of REM sleep. So we have these two types of sleep, non-rapid eye movement sleep, that is called NREM sleep. And rapid eye movement sleep, that is a dream sleep, which is called REM sleep. And you have around 5 to 6 cycles like this in one night over a period of 8 hours. So you go into from light sleep to deeper sleep. Again, you become lighter. Again, you go into deeper sleep. Again, it becomes lighter. So it's a roller coaster ride which we have during the night. Let me tell you about some sleep disorders, the type of patients which we get as a psychiatrist in our clinical practice. You can have insomnia, difficulty in falling asleep, difficulty in maintaining a sleep, or early morning insomnia. The person wakes up very early in the morning. The second, we get hypersomnia, excessive daytime drowsiness. During daytime, you are supposed to attend your lectures, you are supposed to go to your work, you are supposed to do a variety of activities. Instead of that, you feel drowsy, groggy, sleepy. So when you have excessive daytime sleep, it is called hypersomnia or excessive sleep. The third is a sleep-wake cycle disorder. So instead of sleeping at night from 11 in the night to 6 in the morning, which is 8 hours of sleep, or 7 in the morning, which will be 8 hours of sleep, people fall asleep at 2 o'clock in the night or 3 o'clock in the night and wake up at 9 o'clock or 10 o'clock in the morning. So this is what we call sleep-wake cycle disorder. They sleep for 8 hours, but not from 11 to 7, but from 2 in the morning or 3 in the morning till late afternoon sometimes. And then we have what we call parasomnias. These are sleep disorders which occur during sleep, like sleep talking, sleep walking, etc. Bedwetting, passing urine during sleep, etc. Let me tell you about some of the cases which we have seen in our clinical practice. The first case I have titled is as Dheere Se Jana Khatiyan Mein. There was an old Hindi movie, and this was a song of Devanand. A 48-year-old male patient presented with inability to sleep at night and waking up frequently, almost every hourly, due to bed bugs biting. As a result, he felt drowsy during the daytime and would fall asleep for 2 to 3 hours in the afternoon. He came to us and he said, "Dr. Saab, you are working in Sion Hospital. It's a municipal corporation hospital. It's a government hospital. You can afford to fall asleep in the afternoon in any government job. So if you are working in a municipal hospital, you are working in a government office, you can afford to sleep for 2 to 3 hours in the afternoon. But I am working in a private office and I cannot fall asleep for 2 to 3 hours in the afternoon." So he had excessive daytime drowsiness. So what was the cause of excessive daytime drowsiness? I asked him that, "Why do you feel sleepy during the daytime?" He said, "What happens that I am not able to sleep well during the night slide. And because of that, he is drowsy during the daytime." I asked him, "Why are you not able to sleep during the night time?" He says, "There are lots of bed bugs, makkad, and they keep on biting me and they don't allow me to sleep." I said, "Good, but then did you not do anything about makkad, bed bugs?" He said, "No, I tried pest control, a variety of hit and fleet and variety of things I have used. They go away and again within 1 or 2 days they come back. And all of us who have stayed in the hostel, we know that how we can continue to sleep well even with the bed bugs. In hostel, most of the beds have bed bugs and we all have stayed in the hostel and slept with the bed bugs. And we were not really very sure." So usually when we are not very sure, we ask the patient to bring the relative. Next time he came with his wife and we asked his wife that, "What happens, where do you sleep?" So wife says, "I sleep in the same bed as he is sleeping." So we asked wife, "Do you also get the bed bugs bite? Do the bed bugs bite you as well?" She said, "Yes, I also get bed bugs and I sleep in the same bed and there are so many bed bugs, but in spite of the bed bugs, I sleep very well." So we were wondering that how can the wife sleep very well and he cannot. So we went a little bit more in the details and we found that actually he was suffering from anxiety disorder. He was not doing well in his business. He had lots of loans to repay. He had other problems. He was worried about his shop. He was worried about his business. He was worried about his job. He was worried about his family members, children, variety of things he was worried about. He had to pay the installment of his loans. And as a result, he was suffering from anxiety disorder. And because of the anxiety disorder, he was unable to fall asleep. For anxiety disorder, we put him on combination of escitalopram, tablet escitalopram 10 milligram at bedtime, along with tablet clonazepam 0.5 milligram at bedtime. Gradually, over a period of 2 to 3 weeks, his sleep started improving, his anxiety decreased, and in the same beds where he had lots of bed bugs, he started falling asleep. And as his sleep improved over a period of time, even his daytime drowsiness improved, and now he was able to attend his office properly. He was able to go to his shop properly, and he stopped sleeping for 2 to 3 hours in the afternoon. We had this another case of a student, engineering student, Zopi Gelela Jaga Zala, a 20-year-old engineering student. He came to us with the complaints that he was feeling very, very sleepy during the lectures. As our friend mentioned that most of us sleep only for 4 or 5 hours. We do not sleep at night. We do not get good sleep at night. And we feel sleepy during the lectures. So he was also feeling sleepy during the lectures. And that's why he came to us. He also said that he falls asleep in bus, train. Sometimes he has missed stops or station. So he's sitting in the bus and he will feel drowsy, he will fall asleep and he will miss his bus stop. Once or twice, he also missed the station in the train because in the train also he would fall asleep. We thought that whether he's sleeping well at night or not. And he says he has continuous and very, very restful sleep at night. And in spite of that, he's having excessive sleep during the daytime. So this is hypersomnia, daytime excessive drowsiness, and it was not secondary to nighttime insomnia. In the first case, he had actually insomnia, difficulty in maintaining sleep at night, and as a result, he had secondary hypersomnia. Here, his nighttime sleep was very good, but daytime also, he had an excessive daytime drowsiness. For this kind of people, he was first started on tablet modafinil. It's an alerting drug that keeps you alert, awake throughout the day. We started him on modafinil. He was a little better. Then he said he has difficulty in sustaining attention, concentration. So we added another medicine called methylphenidate. You are all pharmacy students and so you might be familiar with these names, modafinil, methylphenidate. After starting methylphenidate, he started getting frightening dreams. And so he said that there are some side effects and after taking these medicines, I am getting frightening dreams. So he stopped all the medicines. After a few days, I was walking on the road and I met him. And I said, how are you doing? He said, I am absolutely fine. I said, what happened to your daytime sleepiness? You were complaining that you were feeling sleepy during the lecture. He said, yes. I have realized that I have stopped all the medications as I have realized that I was not the only person sleeping in the class. Many other students were also feeling sleepy in the class and I was not the only one. So, Zopi Gelela Jaga Zala. I think all of you understand Marathi well. So, he had a realization that it was not only him. He was sleeping excessively during the lectures, but there were many other students and that was not a problem. Otherwise, we were suspecting a sleep disorder called narcolepsy. Narcolepsy, where you get intense desire to fall asleep and anywhere, anytime you fall asleep, you remain asleep for about 20 minutes, 25 minutes, and it's a power sleep. So power sleep for 20 minutes. You rapidly start with the sleep, go into REM sleep. You complete your sleep in 20 minutes and you are fresh and awake. So this is called intense desire, irresistible desire to fall asleep for around 20-25 minutes intermittently during the daytime, disorder called narcolepsy. Let's come on to the another thing. After insomnia and hypersomnia, we have this sleep-wake cycle disorder. Subah ho gayi mamu. This 28-year-old male patient, he was a case of bipolar depression, non-responsive to the treatment with selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, and he was also given electroconvulsive therapy, and he was not showing much improvement. He responded to a combination of mirtazapine and nortriptyline. When we started these medicines, he was better, his depression improved. But he came to us with a complaint that I am absolutely fine. I am no longer depressed, but I am unable to sleep before 4 a.m. in the morning. And then I wake up at 1 p.m. in the afternoon. So he was getting full 8 hours of sleep from 4 a.m. to 1 p.m. And he said it becomes very difficult for him, because most of his family members would go to sleep at 11 o'clock. By 10:30, they will wind up. By 11, they are all fast asleep. He will try to fall asleep. He will do a variety of things to fall asleep, but he will not be able to fall asleep. And it's a dark. He cannot switch on TV. He cannot switch on radio. He cannot use his mobile, because there will be bright light or some sound which will disturb the other people in the house. So he would be just lying down from 11 in the night till 4 in the morning, almost for 5 hours. And then at 4 o'clock, he'll feel drowsy, he will fall sleepy. And when it's a time to wake up at 6 o'clock in the morning, where most of the family members will wake up, will be very, very drowsy, sleepy. And he will fall asleep deep. He will be in deep sleep when the other family members wake up. So this was the situation. And we were thinking what to do in this kind of situation. Now we told him that, see, making somebody fall asleep is a very, very difficult task. So if somebody has insomnia and you say fall asleep, it's very difficult. He will not fall asleep. Even if he tries to fall asleep, he may not be able to fall asleep. But it is relatively easy to wake up somebody from deep sleep. So we started a behavior therapy in which we would wake him early by half an hour for 1 week. So we said, okay, we will start this sleep-wake cycle disorder. This is a sleep-wake cycle disorder. And instead of 1 p.m., we'll wake you up at 12:30. So we told his wife that whatever happens, you sprinkle water on his face, shake him, dip his finger in a hot cup of tea, and then wake him up at 12:30 instead of 1 o'clock. So half an hour early pays advance for 1 week. So for 1 week, instead of 1 o'clock, he will wake up at 12:30. After 1 week, when he has woken up at 12:30, again, now further wake him up at 12 o'clock. So again, half an hour early. So again, for 1 week, he will be woken up by his wife at 12 o'clock, and so on. So every week, we started waking him up early by half an hour. Then they maintained that for 1 week, again, earlier by half an hour. So in over a period of 4 weeks, he started waking instead of 1 o'clock at 11 o'clock. Then for next 4 weeks, instead of 11 o'clock, he started waking up at 9 o'clock. And what we observed that as he is resetting his biological clock in the brain by waking up 2 hours early, he is falling asleep a little better in the night. So instead of 4 o'clock, 4 a.m., he started sleeping by 2 a.m. and then by 12 a.m. and then by 11 a.m. So then gradually over a period of 2 to 3 months, like his family members, he started falling asleep at 11 p.m. in the night and waking up at 7 in the morning. Best time, 11 to 7, 8 hours of good, peaceful sleep. And then depression had improved. He started going to his work. He started doing other activities and he was absolutely fine. Coming on to parasomnias, what we call this case, fire. You might have heard about sleepwalking, sleep talking. There are people who have habit of talking during sleep. There are people who have walking during sleep. Britannia Delight. There was one ad in which the person starts walking during sleep in order to get this Britannia Delight biscuit. So fire, a 33-year-old female patient presented with history of getting frequent nightmares in which she would see her house on fire. She would wake up screaming fire, and would wake up all the family members and sometimes even the neighbors. These kind of episodes she was having earlier once in 2 to 3 months, but now the frequency had increased. Almost once or twice she was getting these episodes. During a typical episode, after falling asleep in the middle of the night, she would suddenly wake up and start shouting, fire, aag lag gai, dekho aag lag gai, jaldi karo. And all the family members will wake up. Somebody will bring a bucket of water and say, kahan aag lagi. And then they will see that she is just half sleepy, half awake and just shouting. And they will go to her, they will wake her up and they say, kahan aag lagi hai? And then from sleep, little drowsy state, she will wake up and say, kya ho gaya? Aap sab log kyun jama ho gaya? And they said, you were shouting fire. She says, no, I was not. She would not have any memory for that. And then she would shout at them, ke, kyun abhi raat ko itne baje jama ho jate ho? Chalo jao, apne apne ghar pe jao. And then she would fall asleep. And she will have complete amnesia, no memory of whatsoever of that night event when she wakes up during the daytime. This is a typical episode of what we call night terror. Her diagnosis was night terror. Now, this type of disorder we see, and when there is a frequent episodes, almost 2 to 3 times in a week, when the person gets this kind of episodes, and when there is a stressful situation where the frequency increases, we give tablet clonazepam, 0.25 or 0.5 milligram at bedtime, and it takes care of this night terror. So we started her on this medicine. She completely recovered. We continued medicine for about 3 months, and after that, we gradually reduced the dose and stopped the medicine. So another sleep disorder which you can come across is night terror. We all know about Kumbhakaran, brother of Ravan in Ramayana. So he was suffering from a sleep disorder. A 36-year-old builder, he came with a complaint of episodes of excessive sleepiness, 18 to 20 hours per day, lasting for 7 days to as long as 45 days. These episodes will last for 7 days, or once it lasted almost for 1.5 months. Suddenly, one fine day, this episode will start. And when the episode starts, instead of waking up in the 7 in the morning, he will fall asleep at 11 p.m. in the night and wake up at 6 p.m. the next day. Then he'll wake up at 6 p.m. and from 6 p.m. to 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. For 5 hours, he will be awake. He will do his routine chores. He will have his food, meals. He will go and take bath. He will go to toilet. He will do some activities. And again at 11 o'clock, he will fall asleep. And he will be so drowsy throughout the night, throughout the day. And next day at 6 o'clock, he will wake up. So instead of 8 hours of sleeping, he was sleeping for 19 hours in a day. And this kind of episode will continuously last for 7 days, 15 days, 20 days. And then he'll suddenly one fine day, he'll become fine. And then again, he will start sleeping for 8 hours. Till again, he will remain fine for 6 months, 1 year, 2 years, and again he will get similar episode of excessive sleepiness, hypersomnia. He had 6 such episodes of either 7 days or 15 days or one lasting for 45 days in last 1 year. He had history of some symptoms of depression during the episode and symptoms of hypomania following the episodes for about a week. This is a typical disorder. This disorder we see once in a while. This disorder is called Klein-Levine syndrome, or the disorder which Kumbhkaran had. We all know Kumbhkaran used to sleep excessively for 6 months and then again he will be awake for 6 months. So this is called Klein-Levine syndrome, a rare syndrome. 1 in 100,000 people get it. But when they get it, they continuously sleep for 18 to 20 hours in a day. Very lucky people. Similarly, some people have this what we call night eating syndrome. They are also called as refrigerator raiders. We had this 46-year-old housewife. She was unable to lose weight despite of not eating anything throughout the day. She was very, very obese, and people, whenever she used to come to our hospital, we would tell her, कि खाना कम करो, खाना कम करो, आपका वजन बहुत ज्यादा है. एंड शी वुड से, मैं पूरा दिन भर कुछ भी नहीं खाती डॉक्टर साहब, मैं पूरा दिन भर कुछ भी नहीं खाती. एंड देन वंस वन ऑफ आवर डॉक्टर्स लॉस्ट टेंपर एंड ही सेड, ऐसे कैसे हो सकता है, पूरा दिन भर कुछ नहीं खाती है तो क्या रात को उठ के खाती हो? एंड शी सेड यस, हाँ डॉक्टर साहब आप सही बता रहे हैं, मैं रात को सो जाती हूँ और बाद में मुझे नींद में बहुत भूख लगती है और फिर मैं उठ के रेफ्रिजरेटर खोल के उसमें जो भी खाना मैंने सुबह से भर के रखा है वो पूरा खा जाती हूँ. सो शी सेड शी डजंट फील लाइक ईटिंग एंड हैज नो एपेटाइट टिल द इवनिंग. सो शी विल वेक अप इन द मॉर्निंग एंड शी विल नॉट फील हंग्री एट ऑल. शी वुड स्किप हर ब्रेकफास्ट, शी वुड स्किप हर लंच टिल द इवनिंग. शी वुड नॉट हैव एनी एपेटाइट. देन शी वुड फील लिटिल हंग्री ड्यूरिंग द इवनिंग टाइम एंड शी वुड ईट समथिंग. And then she would fall asleep, and in the middle of the night, she would wake up in the middle of the night and go on a binge. So she will raid her refrigerator, open the refrigerator, and whatever is there, samosa, patata vada, sandwiches, whatever is chocolates, fruits, whatever she has stocked in the refrigerator, she will eat, have a large meal during night, eat a lot, and then again she'll be able to fall asleep. So many of us have this problem, what we call night eating syndrome, and as a result, our sleep is disturbed. The treatment of this night eating syndrome is one of the SSRI. There is one study of sertraline. You have heard of antidepressant called sertraline, and sertraline may be useful in the treatment of night eating syndrome. We had this 18-year-old girl, and the title of this my case is Kya Bolti Tu. 18-year-old girl, her mother called me one day early in the morning at 6 o'clock, and she said whenever I wake her up in the morning, she doesn't wake up like us fully fresh. She is little drowsy, she is little groggy, she is half asleep, and she speak something when I wake her up. So she is talking some irrelevant things like mathematical equations. She would say a plus b square is equal to a square plus 2ab plus b square. Or she would give some description of experiments when she was awakened by her mother in the morning. So she would say, no, HCl plus H2SO4, and you have to put this H2SO4 into this. And mother say, what are you talking? And she wouldn't know what she is talking. And it would remain for about 30 seconds, and then she will be fully awake. And mother would ask her, "Arey, what were you talking?" And she says, "What I was talking? Nothing." And she would not have memory of that 30 seconds, 45 seconds, where she would wake up in the morning. This episode would last for 30 seconds, 1 minute kind of thing. She would talk such things for a few seconds to a couple of minutes, and then would wake up fully from the sleep without any recall of what she spoke. Now, one day what happened, instead of speaking about some experiments or a chemical formula or arithmetic formula, she said, no, no, you are not my boyfriend. And that was the first time the mother came to know that she had a boyfriend. She had spilled the bean. So first time she realized that, oh, this girl has a boyfriend, and good, lucky that she has this habit of talking when she wakes up in the morning, where she will not be able to hide something which she doesn't want to share with the parents, and she spoke it. And that's why she called me. This is called confused arousal. So one, there is one sleep disorder, what is called as confused arousal, in which when the person wakes up in the morning, he is a little confused, and that confusion remains for a few seconds to few minutes, and then the person fully awakes. So this is kya bolte tu, case of confused arousal. Finally, I have this case of jana tha Japan, pahunch gaye Chin. This 54-year-old bank manager, he wished to quit smoking on the World No Tobacco Day on insistence of his daughter. On World No Tobacco Day, we psychiatrists and health professionals go to various colleges and kind of tell people, college students, that they should quit smoking. Smoking is injurious to health. So quit smoking and help your parents to quit smoking. So this girl who attended this lecture and was very, very impressed, so she went home and told her father, who was a bank manager, that he must quit smoking. And for that, she brought him to my clinic, saying that, doctor, inka cigarette chudana hai. I realized that father was not very keen on stopping smoking. He said, doctor sahab, main khali 4-5 cigarette roj ka pita hun, main jyada cigarette nahi pita hun. I am not really interested in quitting, but because my daughter is insisting, she forced me to come here. She dragged me over here. That's why I have come. So for reducing the craving for smoking, we consider this medicine called topiramate. There is also another medicine called bupropion, but he had a history of seizure 3 years back, and one of the side effects of bupropion, it lowers the seizure threshold. So instead of bupropion, we started him on topiramate 25 milligram twice a day. On the following visit, after a week, his wife came with him, and she was very, very happy, as though he had not left smoking, but he had stopped snoring. The problem which he had lived for last 30 years. So we were actually treating smoking, and we wanted him to quit smoking, and we started topiramate. Instead of that, his snoring reduced and stopped with the topiramate. And wife was so happy, ke doctor sahab, ye goli chalu hi rakhna, wo cigarette piyenge to chalega. But ye goli se mujhe to bahut fayda ho gaya, ke unka snoring band ho gaya, raat ko wo kharate le lete hain, to abhi wo bhi acche se sote hain, main bhi acche se soti hun. So many people have this habit of excessive snoring during sleep, and many of them have what we call sleep apnea syndrome. In sleep apnea syndrome, there is an obstruction to the airflow, and because of the obstruction, there is the snoring. They do it in the night, and not only they get disturbed, they don't get good sleep, and they also disturb the people sleeping around them. And usually there is a PAP machine which they have to wear and sleep, but many of them are not able to afford this machine, BiPAP machine. So we treat them with this tablet called topiramate, and it reduces the snoring of the person. So any of your roommate, room partner, your wife, your colleagues have snoring, and if they want to stop snoring, one can recommend this medicine called topiramate 25 milligram either at bedtime, should be good enough. So thank you very much, this patient listening and allowing me to present this few things about sleep and sleep disorder. So I will stop sharing my slides over here. And if you have any questions, I would be happy to take them.
Thank you so much, sir. I mean, like your worky examples and the titles you gave them along with the case studies made the talk really interesting. And it gave us so much information on a topic we often tend to neglect. And sir, we have a question, or rather a incident which has been given by Ishita to everyone on the chat box. Ishita says, my father snores a lot in his sleep in presence of my mother to a point where she cannot sleep at all. But whenever we are in the same room with him during our trips or during certain functions, he somehow unintentionally stops snoring. What could be the reason for this? Can you please help Ishita?
Sure. See, snoring is a sleep disorder. And one of the common causes of snoring during sleep is sleep apnea syndrome. So what happens that on some days, on certain times when you are at your home and you are sleeping, your posterior part of the palate, which is a soft palate, drops during sleep and it obstructs the airway. And because it obstructs the airway, whenever you breathe, it starts fluttering, and that causes sound of snoring. So you get that sound. That is the snoring. Now, this, the common cause is what we call sleep apnea syndrome or obstructive sleep apnea syndrome. So many of these patients, what we do, they have snoring in some situations. And as you rightly said, that some other situations, they do not get snoring, particularly when they are sitting or they are in a different position or a different place where the soft palate doesn't relax much. See, whenever we go to some new place, we do not sleep as good as we sleep in our own home. So if the sleep is not deep enough, then he may not snore. And as you rightly mentioned, that unintentionally, he doesn't, he stops snoring. So he doesn't know, he doesn't either intentionally snore or doesn't snore. It is not intentional, it is unintentional. So what I suggest that he should undergo a sleep analysis treatment. So there is a sleep laboratory where whole night sleep will be recorded and variety of parameters will be recorded. So it's called somnography. So throughout the night, they will do this and they find out how many times he has sleep apnea. And if he has sleep apnea syndrome, then they will give him a machine, which is called PAP machine, positive pressure machine, which he has to wear and sleep. In the meantime, before we do this sleep study, what is called polysomnography study, if you want, we can consider tablet topiramate for him, 25 milligram at bedtime, which will reduce his snoring and he will be able to have a good restful sleep, as well as your mother and other people, family members who are sleeping along with him in the same room will also be benefited.
Thank you so much, sir. I'm sure you have helped Ishita solve her problem. Sir, we have Yashvi Mehta asking you, her mother seems to have a one-sided skull or head pain when she sleeps. And can you please tell her the reason why this could be happening?
Okay, so her complaint is then whenever she falls asleep, she gets a headache. Is it only during sleep?
Yes, sir. She has mentioned only when she sleeps.
Yeah, there is a condition called hypnic headache. This hypnic headache is a condition where the headache occurs only during sleep. So after the person falls asleep, after 1.5 hours or 3 hours, the person wakes up with severe headache, and then it is unbearable headache. It remains, it wakes up the person from the sleep, and then person remains like that for 30 minutes, 1 hour. Sometimes he has to take some medicines to kill that pain, and then again he is able to fall asleep. It may occur once in a week, it may occur twice in a week, or sometimes it occurs every day. And sometimes it is also similar to migraine. Migraine, what we call adha cc or half head headache, So if she is getting one-sided headache, it may be an episode of migraine. For migraine, we treat migraine. There are some medicines for migraine. And for prophylactic prevention of migraine, one can use propranolol, a beta blocker, amitriptyline, and flunarizine. These are the three medicines which have been used for migraine. So anytime we can evaluate her, we can go in more details and start her on this treatment. And definitely she will have good relief from this nighttime headache or hypnic headache.
Thank you, sir. I think our audience is really loving this session because we have a whole lot of questions coming in. Sakina wants to ask, Doctor, many a times we are extremely sleepy and exhausted, but for some reason you still don't get sleep. So what could be the reason behind it? Can you please help her?
Yes. Sleep, as I said, is a very, very important thing. And the environment is very, very important. And our health is very, very important. So what happens for good sleep, we have to follow certain principles of sleep hygiene. So before you fall asleep, you have to totally relax. You should not be excited. Your brain should not be excited. And the environment should be very, very conducive to sleep. The bed should be good. The temperature should be good. The lighting should be minimum. The sound should be minimum. You should have a loose clothes. All these things will enhance your sleeping experience. Now, what happens that when we have full day work, say, for example, we have gone on picnic or we have done lots of running and exhausting and lots of work, the brain is overstimulated. There is excessive stimulation of the brain. And as a result, when we are trying to fall asleep, we are not able to forget those things. And those things keeps on. Ha, picnic mein gaye the, esne aisa kiya, usne waisa kiya, hum logon ne bahut maja kiya. And those kind of thoughts keep on coming. And as a result, we are unable to fall asleep. So though we are very, very tired and exhausted, we are unable to sleep. Similarly, if our sleep-wake cycle is disturbed, so if we have a habit of, say, sleeping, waking up at 7 o'clock in the morning, but on that particular day, because of the picnic, we had woken up at 4 o'clock or 5 o'clock in the morning. So there is a sleep deprivation. And then in the afternoon, while traveling in the bus, we have had a nap. And while coming back, we had a nap. So the whole sleep-wake cycle is disturbed. And as a result, many people complain that after an exhausting day, they have difficulty in falling asleep. Simple principles of sleep hygiene. You should be able to switch on and switch off your brain. So half an hour before, say you have to fall asleep at 11 o'clock, at 10:30, wind up. So in winding up, you switch off your computer, you switch off your mobile, put it on charging. Go and change your clothes. If you have a habit of taking bath, you take a warm bath, change your clothes, wear loose clothes, adjust your fan or AC if you are a habit of sleeping in the AC. Have a good bed, which is a comfortable, arrange your pillows positions of pillow, and then switch off. Do not work.
Yes, student, please mute.
Yeah, very important that before, half an hour before going to bed, you should be in a relaxed mind. You should not be thinking. You are not supposed to do any mental activities. You are not supposed to do some arithmetic calculations. You are not supposed to plan your day ke kal kya karenge, parso kya karenge. Now it's a time to relax and switch off. And once you are able to switch off, ki abhi kuch sochna nahi hai, bas I will think of just relaxing and sleeping. So then you will be able to fall asleep.
Thank you, sir. Sir, now Dinsey has a question, which I'm sure is like a question all of us students have. Some of us students tend to wake up early for study and some stay up late till night. So which is a good way according to you? And please draw our attention towards what people can do to adjust their sleep cycle accordingly, like waking up late or sleeping early. What can they do? Can you help us with it?
One important thing is regularity and synchrony. in my second slide, I talked about both the things, regularity and synchrony. Now, if your college starts at 9 o'clock in the morning and you have to attend the lectures from 9 o'clock to 4 o'clock, then obviously during that time you cannot fall asleep. So obviously you are going to sleep at night. If you are doing a night duty, like many workers have a night duty, then they work at night and they sleep during daytime. Like many of the nurses in our hospital, they have night duty. So continuously you have to have a regularity. So if you are doing night duty, then yes, you do the night duty and sleep at daytime. Night duty, sleep at daytime. Continuously you do that. Then if you have to change the duty, then take a break for one full day, change your sleep habit. So instead of sleeping during the day, you sleep at night and then readjust your sleep-wake cycle and then again start sleeping at night. Now, if you are not doing that, then you are asking for a big problem. Since your college hours are during the morning and you are not going to a night school or night college, I would recommend that since we are staying on planet Earth and Earth has its own day and night cycle, we synchronize our sleep-wake cycle with day and night cycle. Since your college is in the morning, during daytime, you have to remain awake and fresh. So if your college is starting at 9 o'clock or 8 o'clock, better you are fresh and alert at that time. So better you sleep well at night from 11 in the night to 6 or 7 in the morning. Get up in the morning, fresh, awake, get ready, go to your college, study, and you will have because you had a good sleep, you will be able to attend the college very well. Full day you can attend the college. In the evening, you can go out, you can study, you can have pleasure, you can go to Juhu Beach nearby, you can go to nearby restaurants, so many, and dosa and idli wala nearby. Enjoy. And then by 10, 10:30, start winding up so that you can fall asleep by 11. Switch off your brain saying, no, I want to now sleep for a while. Have a good 8 hours of sleep, which is absolutely, absolutely essential. Earlier, when we were students, we were taught that brain do not have lymphatic system. So there is no cleaning of the brain. But now, in 2012, a group of neurologists or neuroscientists who might get a Nobel Prize have found that even the brain has a lymphatic system, and it is called glymphatic system. Brain mein, whenever we work, whenever we do activities, lots of kachra, the oxidative stress, what is called as jama ho jata hai. And that kachra needs to be cleaned. Now, this cleaning process occurs when you sleep. And if you sleep continuously for 8 hours in a recumbent position, then only it is fully clean. And your brain is recharged. If you do not sleep continuously for 8 hours, your brain is not fully recharged. That cleaning process of the brain doesn't occur. And then it affects your health. So then next day morning, you will feel a little drowsy. You will have problem with attention, concentration. You will be sleepy during the lecture. So my simple recommendations, sleep well from 11 in the night to 7 in the morning so that the whole day you can remain awake. If possible, like they do it in Pune and Goa, what they call susegar, laid back attitude, relax. So I would recommend, if possible, in quotes, 1 hour to 2 hours sleep in the afternoon. That is physiological. It enhances our health. So many colleges like in Pune and Goa and in Middle East, they have school from 7 in the morning till 12 in the afternoon. 2 o'clock you go to sleep. Again 4 to 7 in the evening, that is a college. That is still better system. But if you have to sleep only once, 8 hours of sleep in the night, plus, additionally, I would recommend 1 or 2 hours, if possible, during afternoon.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much. We have the last question from Vormi, who says her father has to work at night for international meetings most of the days. And this has led to his sleep, which has become as less as 5 hours. So can you help her?
Yes, definitely. See, work is important. But for our health, sleep is more important than work. Health is very, very important. And if you are not sleeping well for at least 8 hours, then it takes toll on your health. Gradually, your immune system will get affected. Your heart will get affected. Your lungs, your kidneys, your liver, everything will get affected. And most your brain will get affected. And then you will invite all types of disorders, heart disease, blood pressure, diabetes. So I recommend that if he is doing international work and he has to remain awake at night, that at least he should take, suppose he is taking 5 hours of sleep. Say, for example, he is sleeping at 5 o'clock in the morning till 10 o'clock in the afternoon. 3 hours of sleep he is losing every day. 3 ghante ka karz, that is debt he is having. He has to compensate it. So either he can have 3 more hours of sleep at a stretch or in the afternoon or in the evening hours. So please request him to complete his 8 hours of quota of sleep every day. If still that is not possible, at least weekends. Many of us do the same thing, that if we had exams and we work little more throughout the week and we sleep 1 hour less throughout the week, then 6 hours less we have slept on Sunday. We sleep from 12 to 6 in the afternoon. Sunday sleep, beauty sleep. And then we compensate for 1 hour debt and we sleep that way. Sleep is very, very important. It is necessary for survival. And 6 to 8 hours of sleep is must for everyone, whether it's a father, mother, children, anybody. So please give importance to sleep and sleep well, which is very, very healthy.
Thank you so much, sir. Sir, it's not daily that I come across such
yes,
a
Yes, sir.
Okay, we'll continue. It's not daily that I get the chance of coming across such an eminent personality who has so much knowledge on a particular field. So I cannot help being selfish and I'll ask a question from my side as well. Sir, when you gave us the example of Kumbhkaran, so you spoke about the Klein-Levine syndrome. So sir, can we associate it with the African sleeping sickness which we have come across in our curriculum?
Okay. Now, this sleeping sickness is a viral disorder. So that is another disorder altogether where the hypothalamus, where the sleep center is affected. And as a result, they are sleeping excessively. So sleeping sickness is a disorder, it's an illness. The totally different disorder is this Klein-Levine syndrome. In sleeping sickness, it is not episodic. It is continuous. While this Klein-Levine syndrome is episodic and there is no viral infection, there is no fever, there is no malaise, there are no other symptoms. If you are lucky, you might get it. It's a pure luck that you will sleep continuously for 18 hours. Nothing to do. You are not responsible. Sleep at 11 o'clock in the night. Sleep continuously for 18 hours. Wake up at 6 o'clock in the evening. Have your meals. If you are married, have sex. And then again go to sleep. Wonderful life. Sleeping, eating, having slept. No work. So not all of us are lucky to get this illness, Klein-Levine syndrome. But once in a while you get it. And it could last for 7 days. Enjoy vacation, no work. And you get repeated episodes. So one after another, 3-4 times in a year, good vacation.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much for this insightful session. And you have explained it very well through different case studies. We are really grateful to you. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much. Like your examples and the quirky names you had given it and your vast experience with the case studies really enlightened us. So to sum it all up, I'll give a vote of thanks. Thank you would be too small a word to express our gratitude. I would like to extend a heartfelt thank you to Nilesh, sir, for taking out time from his busy schedule and telling us so much about the topic we hardly knew about. For us, sleep was like a time pass sort of a thing, but now we realize how important sleep is. I also thank our principal ma'am, who is not present here, but she has been a cornerstone for us throughout this journey. Also, a big thank you to all our teachers and the council for organizing such amazing events for us every now and then. Lastly, a big shout out to our audience for their participation. Hope you all thoroughly enjoyed the event and take something useful away from it. Thank you. Hoping to see you all soon in our next event. This is Anish Shivathaya signing off. Good night.
Good night.